This is a great day because the cat is coming out of the bag, and it's exactly as I expected it to be. So I'm very upbeat, although nervous, because I know here comes the activation. The activists are going to be activated. You see, the globe has been programmed, like a programming has taken place within them. And this programming is sitting there like a program on a computer, software program. Once you get the key to activate the program, then the program starts working automatically. But without that key, it doesn't work. So all along I've been saying, look, there's this terrible situation that's going to come. The world is going to be flooded with severe activism designed to crush a certain segment, a certain attitude, a certain belief system in the world. And I happen to be affiliated with that belief system, that the intention is to crush that belief system. So of course I understand I'm in the crosshairs, so I have to be very alert to what's going on. And I know it's going to happen very soon. I have terrible nervous symptoms recently and anxiety, meaning it's coming. What is the key to activate the program? What's going on with that? Well, of course I knew during the time of the 16th of August through the 22nd, something there would provide that key in some way, but it hasn't quite been given out to people yet. So today I just happened to be, someone else had the television on, and I just heard something in walking past. I said, uh-oh, that's the key. What is it? Oh, these images about the gas attack in the raw video, etc., is being made now. It's on the Senate's website. You know, it's going to make its way out into the world in some way. That is the key. That is the way to activate the activists. They've been waiting for this key to activate them, and so that they can feel completely self-righteous about their position, even though it's just utter, complete madness, their position, actually. So that's great, because this is the time when we are going to get the help. So this is the time that I've been waiting for. So it's really fantastic. As the activists activate, you will have what Jesus pointed out is families divided, houses divided against each other, absolutely. Because the activists now will be over the top with saying, okay, it is now time for our agenda to sweep aside any opposition whatsoever. How can you stand up for gassing those children, you know? It's like that. That's the ultimate trump card, they think. And if you don't finally collapse to their point of view, that means you are all for the gassing of young innocent children with nerve gas or something. You see, that's what they're going to pin on you. So that's what I'm talking about, is dirty pool, very dirty pool, of course. Those who are attempting to accomplish the impossible, what other cards can they play except very dirty cards, you know, very nasty stuff. They don't have anything else. They just have an extreme guilt trip to try and lay on you. So, as I said, I do expect a response now to this guilt trap that's been sprung on the world. It's all been set up so reason flies out the window, as it were. You're either for gassing children or you're against it. And that's the dichotomy that they've set up. See, the ego is very clever at setting up these incredible dichotomies that bring about massive guilt in you, which then make you feel that the no we can't, they equate it with, oh, you mean no we can't prevent women and children from being gassed? You know, or, no we can't do that. That's what you're saying, huh? So they pin this false conclusion, this false position on you, which is not at all what you're saying at all. As a matter of fact, the only way to prevent all this is to say, no, we can't accomplish the impossible. Never. And that then enables us to repent and accept that we have a continuity problem, turn the continuity problem over to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit solves the entire situation. No gassing, no death whatsoever, you see. So it's the ones that say, yes, we can accomplish the impossible. Yes, we can learn how to die to what we are. They're the ones who are promoting the gassing, actually, even though they don't see it. Even though they don't see it. And they feel so guilty about this. You know, they project the guilt onto others, and you have a completely upside-down, backwards situation going on with guilt, fear, projection, blame. The whole ball of wax is now present. And it's a maelstrom. I mean, it's scary. It's scary. Because you say, you know, madness is scary. Make no mistake about it. You have to be a perfect guru to not be scared by utter madness, really. Because you're not in it at all. I mean, you don't experience it at all. If you have any doubts or at all, you're going to feel the madness of the times. And that's really too much. Then you're going to feel like it's just coming in upon you, as it were. Because it really is a complete belief system built on insanity is now flexing its muscles and deciding that it is going to use its entire arsenal to crush opposition. So it's time to get out of harm's way, for sure. It's time to sidestep this situation, for sure. And it could be today, it could be tomorrow, it could be the next day. It could be very short time frame right now as far as sidestepping this goes. Because again, very quickly, we're going to have this new mental structure in place where if you don't agree with a certain position, you are supporting the gassing of babies. Okay, they managed to, twist and distort and upside down and backwards and everything. And it's madness. It's absolute madness. The real truth is no one's ever been born. So no one can ever be cast. That's the truth. The very fact that people believe we've been born puts them into harm's way for all sorts of things. All sorts of things. Some people would say that just the aging process is far worse than being gassed. It's like a slow gassing. It's terrible, absolutely horrendous. And yet nobody says a word about that. And of course, believing that you have been born, then you're identifying with the aging process, believing it's happening to you. So this delusion is so severe right now. And activists, what they do is they short-circuit their reasoning process. They find a way to short-circuit it. That's what they've been trying to do all along. They've just been, how can we completely short-circuit our reasoning process so we don't have to listen to reason at all? That's what the ego's goal is. So it can get you completely, not listening to the Holy Spirit or reason at all. Reason comes from the Holy Spirit. So it's trying to get you to divorce yourself, to separate yourself, to wall yourself out. It's trying to make a firewall through the reasoning process. And this whole gassing of the babies is a firewall that people are now frantically, oh good, I can download this firewall and get that firewall in there, and then I don't have to listen to reason at all because I have the Trump card for that. But how can lies trump truth? They cannot. They just keep trumping other lies, which is nothing at all. So of course this nervousness I've been feeling is entirely justified. I haven't been reading or following the news, so I don't know what's going on. I just happened to hear this walking by. I said, this is definitely the key. This is what's going on. Is now people will, again, they'll download this, as it were, into their mental programming. And they say, this is a firewall against reason. I finally have the firewall I've been working on. People have been working on this firewall constantly. So they can get to this irrational condition, sort of irrationality unabated, you might say, an unabated irrationality, which whimsically believes it's the new truth. It's the new truth. Again, unabated irrationality, the ego claims that's the new truth. The new creation, the new reality. Hey, that's what's going on. So, at least there's somebody here who can see it, and I know there are others out there who can see it. They may not be able to express it, as clearly as they want to, but you don't have to. As long as you see it, that's good enough. I've just been trained to express it, but that doesn't mean that my seeing is better than someone else's. I mean, there may be people out there who see it better than I see it, and they're just not trained to express it as well. I've been trained in I have a history of very much expressiveness in this world, including putting stuff out into the world that isn't accepted by the world. I was a composer, composed a lot of music in the previous life, and some of the stuff that I put out there was very much panned by the critics and booed and hissed and stuff. And then later on, down the road, people started saying, wow, that's really great stuff. But, you know, oftentimes you get severely attacked for expressing, you know, yourself in this world. So I have a long history, actually, of doing that. So I'm able to express this here, even though, of course, the critics would absolutely savage it, you know, the activists. But again, that in no way does that mean that I see it the most clearly at all. No way. There very well may be those in this world who have greater clarity about the whole situation, and just are not trained to express in the face of overwhelming, you know, disdain and opposition. But it's not like I enjoy this, really. You know, it's nerve-wracking. You know, you don't like to be savaged by critics. You know, nobody does. But anyway, I'm just able to do that. And of course, I have a, you know, certain degree of clarity. For instance, you can't compose some really great works of musical art unless you really know what you're doing. It doesn't happen by luck, you know. It happens because you blood, sweat, and tears, and overall contextual understanding of the whole genre of music and tones and how to work with all those tones, etc. You have to have an overview of the situation. So what I have is an overview of this situation and expressing what's going on in the face of soon to come a tsunami of activists, of course. So of course I have to get out of harm's way, absolutely. I may be one of the first to get out of harm's way, because I'm certainly in harm's way, you know. So we will see how that goes. The spokespeople for an opposition, you know, are generally not treated so kindly. Because the last thing they want is somebody to clearly enunciate what's going on. No, they want everybody to be in confusion. Cowed, confusion, quiet. You know, because they say, well, quiet means consent. That's their logic. Say, well, no, you consented because you were quiet. I think Jesus said that those who know have a great responsibility to share what they know, and those who don't know obviously don't have that responsibility. And he said, if you know and you don't share what you know, he'll say, I don't know you. So, yeah. But I think that's a little harsh, because many may know, but they've not been trained to express it at the verbal level like this. It's really a long, long training I've had working on this. My whole life I've been working on it. How to express unpopular viewpoints, and continuously practicing. So it's you know, it's not something that comes easy at all, because you'll find that the words just kind of stick in your mouth. They don't flow out. You know, it's like very difficult, actually. Very, very difficult. Even though internally you can look and say, I see exactly what's going on. But there's a taboo against expressing it. So you have to be very determined, very forceful, you know, very intense, and a real battler to get these words out. You have to be like on the front line. So sort of a tough, you know, really tough cookie to do it. And it certainly has wiped me out, wipe anybody out, I think, if you're really talking truth in this world. It's that's a tough go. So maybe I will be able to get some protection coming up now, because again, the activists are on the march. The army ants are going to be on the march now. They have the firewalls. Again, what is the ego's goal at one level here? Unabated irrationality. And they don't care if you point out it's irrational. They don't care, because they believe if it's unabated, it will become real. It's like unabated lies. What does lies believe? That if lies are unabated, they will become true. What else can it believe? What else can lies believe except that? Nothing. They've got nothing else. They just say, no, if we just stay in this lie forever, it will become true. There's no other, nothing else to stand on. Lies have nothing else to stand on whatsoever. That's why lies cannot tolerate any real dialogue. And you've noticed this with the activists, right? There's no dialogue. I've noticed this with the activists. Whatever the activists are pushing, whether it's, you know, radical feminism, or the gay agenda, or, you know, the reparations movement, black supremacy, you know, on and on and on, various things. There's no dialogue. There's no allowable dialogue at all. There's never been any dialogue, because they want their viewpoint, the irrationality, to be unabated, and that they feel that will mean that they are right, and therefore they're speaking truth, and therefore they have created truth for themselves, and there must be the new prime creator then. So make no mistake about it, activists are after unabated irrationality. No dialogue, no real communication at all. They may sit there and pretend to be listening to you, but they're not. They're absolutely not. And they may seem to be entertaining truth, but they're not. They're not. They're just trying to figure out, you know, how can I get this irrationality unabated? Now, the ego might say, well, you want truth to be unabated. Now, I don't want truth. Truth is unabated. It already is the case. Remember, it's irrationality that's trying to displace truth. We're not operating in a vacuum here. All right? Truth already is true. Creation already has been created. We already are what we are. We already are the eternal presence. And it's lies that are trying to get rid of that. So, your apples and oranges, you can't equate the two. The idea of saying truth is only true because it's unabated. No, truth is unabated because it's true. You see, that's primary. And the attempt to get rid of that is the attempt to have lies unabated. But that still doesn't work. Lies are still lies. Lies are still lies. Level confusion, the ego brings it in all the time, constantly. It's its constant companion. So here we go with unabated irrationality. And as somebody who values real dialogue, or a real communication, real consideration, real contemplation, real clarification, I can feel the pressure. It's like, you know, being sensitive to the weather. You say, uh-oh, you know, I can feel the weather system coming in. And you know, oh my gosh, this is a hurricane coming in. You can feel it if you're sensitive to it. Some people are very sensitive to various things. Whatever your position is, if there's something trying to impinge upon it, of course you're going to feel it. So I am feeling this massive crush towards rationality, towards reason, towards truth, towards facts, towards repentance, towards all of this, by this desire for unabated irrationality. And the more irrational you are, the more your higher position you get, and higher profile you get in the world these days. You're held up as a role model. You know, the more impulse control problems you have, the more easily you snap. You're a role model now. You're all over the news here. And so this baby gassing thing is the perfect firewall for those irrational activists to hide behind and claim, we're not irrational. There you're right. Look at that. That's irrational. We're perfectly sane. We're just trying to get rid of that. It's the perfect little dress to hide under, you know. Absolutely. It's a camouflage that they're using it now. They're going to use it. In other words, it deflects attention away from their own irrationality, right? And it gives them justification to be irrational, unabated irrational, because they claim, oh no, we're just trying to right this wrong. But no, they're just using it as an excuse. Just using it as an excuse. And whether there are strikes or not doesn't matter. That's not the point. The point is this is now a key to activate their own activism across the board, to platform, to justify the whole platform of radical activism in every possible way. We've only seen the tip of the iceberg. And again, they want to be unabated, which means what? Getting rid of all those who are reasonable. And that's what's been happening in this world. I've seen a massive falling away of reasonable people on this planet. The attitude, the willingness to be reasonable has almost extinct on this planet. It's a whole different way of being, isn't it? A whole different way. You say, let's just sit down and be quiet here. Let everything just settle down first, so there's no emotionalism going on. Let's be in our reasonable mind. Let's tune into reason. Let's tune into that radio station. So let's get all the jingly jangly stuff out of our system first. Of course, if you've been listening to the radio, all the jingly jangly hypey stuff, television, turn off the TVs, turn off the radios, let all this emotionalism and reactionism and all this stuff get out of our system, and let us see if we can discern a fact, a real fact first. Let's start there. So reason has this whole way of going about it. The world is not fostering reason. It's not going about doing this at all. It's just the opposite. It's fostering irrationality and activism towards getting rid of reason. So I've said the Holy Spirit's going to intervene, for sure. It may intervene right now, as a matter of fact. I have seen that this will take place right at this particular snapshot in history, no question about it. So it could be any time, even today. The clock is really ticking on that now, no question about it. And we may say, oh, Holy Spirit, no, we're not in trouble. We're so reasonable that we can handle this. No, we can't. No, we cannot. It would take perfect reason to handle this situation. And I certainly don't have perfect reason. In other words, it takes a perfect guru to handle this present situation, and we're not perfect. So I remember when the Holy Spirit told me, stop watching television right now. This is it. No more. I said, what do you mean? No more. So right now, turn off the television and don't go back to it. You're finished with it. And I said, wow, that's heavy duty. I said, I'm reasonable enough to handle this. The Holy Spirit says, no, you're not. No, you're not. You don't understand the fanaticism of the opposition, the drive to unabated irrationality. You cannot grasp that. You don't have that context to handle it yet. So I said, okay, you know, I'll go with you on that one. And turned out to be, you know, fabulous advice. So likewise, the Holy Spirit's going to come into the world and say, look, time to leave, time to relocate, time to get to safety, time to get to a safe dwelling place. And I will say, no, I can, I understand what's going on. I can handle it. You know, I've clearly vetted. I see it. And the Holy Spirit will say, no, you're not, you cannot handle it. It's, again, the fury and the drive towards unabated irrationality is a furious, vicious, fanatical madness that has deeper roots than you realize. And you won't be able to make it. And that's a very humbling thing. You know, I said, I've spent my whole life trying to be able to make it, and now you're telling me I cannot. You know, it's a little blow to the pride, for sure. But fortunately, I've been vetting this whole situation frantically to the point where it's softening the blow to the pride, you know, softening it, for sure. Because everybody likes to think that they can handle situations or fix them or do something about it. But when you hear, like, wow, you know, you just have to go cold turkey on this. You can't fix it. You can't deal with it. Because, again, their purpose is unabated irrationality. So there's nothing to fix until they give up that goal. Until that goal, they realize, I just crumbles, and I have to find a new goal, a new purpose. Until that's there, you cannot reason with them. Cannot. Can't get through to them. They're going to demand that you accept their irrationality as the new truth. They're not asking you, is this true? What is truth? No, they're saying, this is what we want. We want this to be the new truth. They're not saying, is this true? They're saying, we have decided that we're going to make this the new truth. We're going to force it to be the new truth. We're going to force all these formations to dance to this new truth. And a formation includes your body and your house, your environment, everything, okay? So that's what's happening. They don't care whether it's true or not. That's not the point. They say, we're going to make it true. So you're dealing with a whole different mindset that, for me, I don't have sufficient panoramic vision and clarity enough to easily, you know, dismiss this. I can dismiss it, but not easily. And that's not good enough. Which is fine. It's great. Amazing thing happened two nights ago. I spoke about it on one of the videos already. I'm watching a San Francisco Giants baseball game, and Yasmero Petit is this journeyman pitcher, 28 years old. He's been in organized baseball for 12 years. He's been in the minor leagues toiling. He was up occasionally with a team, Arizona Diamondbacks, and then they dropped him back to the minors, and then they released him. The Giants picked him up, and then he came up and then sent back down, and then the Giants cut him from their 40-man roster, designated for assignment. They re-signed him. They cut him again. Re-signed him again. I mean, this guy is on the fringe of just being nothing. Finally, they have an injury, the Giants, and they bring him up. And he's had like three incredible starts. In the last start, he had a perfect game until the very last hitter, two balls, two strikes. He threw a perfect pitch, and the guy didn't swing, and it was barely a ball. And then the next pitch, the guy got a hit by 6 inches, and he missed the perfect game by just this much. Okay, amazing thing. And you know what? He wasn't bothered by it. He said, you know what? Great accomplishment. I pitched a shutout, a one-hit shutout complete game. And for me, from where I came from, to open eyes like this and just completely dominate a very good team, you know, that validated him. He's been validated entirely. I mean, I know, you know, a good pitcher when I see it. And that guy has got my attention now. Next time he pitches, I'm going to watch him, because he showed everybody what he can do. The fact he didn't get a perfect game, you know what? That's actually a great thing for him. Because if he would have gotten a perfect game, he wasn't ready for it. The hype that goes with that, the pressure and the expectation that go with that, throwing a perfect game, would have overwhelmed him. He's not ready for that. You know, maybe cover of Sports Illustrated, you know, regionally, toast of the town, plaques and awards and all this stuff, you know. Hey, he just wants to keep on pitching. That's all he wants. And by throwing the game like that, everybody now knows who this guy is. And you know, I can't wait to see his next game. You know, this guy is showing something that is really amazing, actually. Amazing. His control is just incredible. It's fabulous stuff. So, of course, I'm going to watch. So, that's what's important, and he gets it. He understands it. He says, hey, it's okay. It's a blessing from God what's happened, and I didn't get the perfect game. That's all right. I'm here. I'm opening eyes. I'm doing what I want to do, and that's fine. So, great attitude, and I picked up on that, and I realized I am not going to be a perfect guru in this cycle. All right? Fine. Near perfection. I almost made it, but not quite. That's okay, because I'm not ready for it. Next cycle, possible, you know, most likely next cycle, yeah, but not this one, not this game. That's all right, no biggie, you know. There'll be other games, just like that pitcher. He'll pitch many other games, and you know, winning's the name of the game, actually, there. So, you know, they won the game, but if a perfect game comes, that's great. If you become a perfect guru, you find yourself coming back into a world to help out, fine. That's fine if you're ready for it. If you're ready for it. So, again, that helped me out a lot. His attitude helped me out a lot. He wasn't bothered. He was kind of, initially, he goes, but he released it, and then it's all fine. I could tell he wasn't devastated in the slightest bit, which is, says a lot about the guy. That means he's a real, he's paid his dues. He knows how tough it is, and he's not going to let anything stop him. And that's how I feel. If I'm not a perfect teacher, numbers, perfect clarity here, this cycle, fine, that's okay. I got very close to it. So if the Holy Spirit says, hey, all right, time to pull out, means you're not a perfect clarity, I say, yeah, okay. Of course, maybe be a little disappointed that you could not give a bigger boost, but that will come. One more, please. Again, my position is only those who have perfect gurus, perfect teachers, can truly handle a situation without being sucked into the madness now. So if the perfect teacher comes and tells you, hey, you need to bail on this situation, hey, pay attention to him. Believe him, trust him in that regard. They're telling you the truth. They're telling you the truth. And they wouldn't even need to tell you that if you were a perfect teacher, because you wouldn't need to bail. So if they say, look, you're not perfect teacher yet, so time to bail. Time to bail on the situation. Absolutely, that is true. Pay attention to that and consider that. And it's no knock on you or anybody else at all. You didn't pitch a perfect game, okay? Rarely does that ever happen. But, just like that pitcher, Jasmero Petit, he now has put himself on the map. And nobody's going to forget that. Nobody's going to forget it. No matter where he goes, they're going to say, hey, I saw that game. I know what you're capable of doing. And that gives him a whole different status, actually. He really attained a whole different status just like that. Amazing, amazing story. And all the other pitchers saw it, too. They said, Matt Cain said, who has pitched a perfect game, he said, I've never seen anybody, hit his spots as well as he did that night. He said maybe he only missed three spots the entire night. He said that's unheard of. So they were blown away. They said, wow, this guy is just amazing. So they know too. So it's in the psyche, in the consciousness, that type of thing. Even though the perfect game didn't happen, that's okay. I think it was good that it didn't happen for him. Just like for me, no. I think being a perfect guru now, it's probably good that it doesn't happen. Actually, really, I'm not set up for that. Not ready for that situation. So here we are, with the activists putting in their key as fast as they can, like that software. You got your software, and there's this long string of numbers and letters and everything. You gotta type them in. Click. Then it has to, activate the program. It takes a while to activate. So they're frantically typing all that into their psyche. And it'll take a little while for the program to become fully functional. And up on their screen, it finally will pop, boom, the program, And then click, and the program will tell them exactly what to do, how to go about this crushing all the opposition to their unabated irrationality. And again, they may know it's irrational. They may know they're irrational. It doesn't matter. They don't care. Because they say, once it becomes unabated, it'll be the new truth anyway. And we'll be used to it at that time. But keep in mind that truth cannot be unseated by lies. So when you believe that lies have become the new truth, truth is still within you. And what happens then is you think that you need to somehow amalgamate the truth from a position of lies. And that's when you try to do the mutual exclusive thing. One of the ways that you'll do it. And that's when you have this epiphany that you can't do that. You can't do it. You find out, wow, I can't make lies true, and I can't entertain both truth and lies simultaneously. Amalgamate them into one whole. then that's when you say, uh-oh, I need some help. Where's the help? And then the Holy Spirit, he says, I'm here. I've been here all along. He just didn't went ready to turn to me. So that'll happen. That'll happen for everybody who's going down this path of unabated irrationality. They will have their Waterloo for sure. Absolutely for sure. You just have to wait until they've had their Waterloo. And they realize, uh-oh, can't do that. Now, as they get closer to that, they may start studying perfect gurus. So they say, how do I defeat these people? How do I integrate them into lies? And there's one big integration. And so then maybe you become aware of them. And then once they have this epiphany, like, oh, this doesn't work, then they'll be able to turn to these perfect gurus and say, hey, I need some help. Do you have some help for me? That kind of thing. So it's all positive. It's lies. It's all positive. But it's a little scary right now. Because it's the unknown. You don't know, you know, what the activists, what's going to happen. But you know what? I don't want to find out, actually. It's kind of like saying, you know, on the television, I said, well, I don't know how they're going to do that with the television and all this stuff. And but the Holy Spirit said, forget it. You got to stop watching. I don't care. You know, you'll find out later, which I did, basically. Same thing with the activists now. You know, we don't know exactly how they're going to act and their moves and everything. It doesn't matter. It's all designed for unabated irrationality. I talk about the goddess of destructivity coming to the planet. I was aware of that. What this is it's a program. It's a program of unabated irrationality designed to trick to you know, get that moving on this planet. It's sort of a psychic complex, and I actually tested this complex out as it somehow managed to get released from jail, as it were, and get past the defenses of this planet and get into this planet, get into the psyche of this planet. And I, you know, poked her. I said, hey, you know, have you changed? Have you seen the errors of your way? Have you finally realized that you're mistaken? Have you finally decided to drop your irrationality? I was peppering her with these questions. And there wasn't the slightest crack in it at all. Absolute fury, absolute irrationality, absolute determination to be completely irrational, unabated irrationality. Yeah. Well, sure, determination. So that psychic complex is a concentration of our desires. Very concentrated. That's what I found. Very concentrated. But of course, it has no effect on reality whatsoever. But it certainly has an effect on our decisions and stuff. It can certainly unnerve us, no question about it. I was very unnerved by that encounter. I realized, wow, this complex is completely irrational. This is the essence of irrationality here, arriving on this planet. And it's like pouring corn syrup in detergent. I mean, it slowly sinks down. I mean, but, you know, eventually it hits the bottom and takes up residence there. So this concentrated irrationality has been here in the world, super concentrated, and it has actually been building up the situation that we're presented with right now, and the attitudes of people towards the whole situation, getting ready to push them, activate them into this drive towards unabated irrationality. Sherman's drive to the sea, as it were. Just, you know, raise everything, burn everything, completely annihilate, you know, all traces of rationality in the world. So then everyone will say, hey, we won. We now live in a yes we can paradise. Yes we can get rid of truth. Yes we can. What a wonderful paradise we live in. Yeah. Of course they will find that this dynamic is still active and it will come for them too. Because truth is still inside of them, you see. And so nobody is safe within such a irrational situation. Nobody's safe. takes a lot of effort here to express this. All right. That should do it. Except for a quiet period here. Humility right now, just humility. Just say, okay, I didn't get the perfect game. That's okay. I got the win, got the shutout, got the complete game, got the one hitter, got everyone's attention, got this, and okay. That's a lot, got a lot. So, perfect game, it's more than I wanted at this time in my career, so to speak. It was more than I wanted, so everything worked out perfect. Everything worked out perfect. I just accept that, and there's a release. You know, everything's worked out perfect, actually. So here we go. I told you it could be any day. Today is probably the day. The whole thing is now, you know, it's all on. It's all on. September, the pivotal month, and here we are for sure. For sure. All right. Here we go, and I'll give you frequent updates if necessary. Okay, hang in there.